Hello and welcome to the concert series. I'm Kathleen Kajioka. That was a theme from a very popular work by Johannes Brahms, his Variations on a Theme by Haydn. It's very well loved as an orchestral work, but actually it was originally written for two pianos. This is true of a lot of popular orchestral music. In fact, the repertoire for piano duo is surprisingly vast. And it's surprising because we don't get much exposure to it. And why is that? The answer would be pianists. Great pianists are a lot like great tennis players. Many of them can play a fantastic singles game, but not so many play well with others. Only a diehard tennis fan could list for you the great doubles partners of history, and that same tennis fan could also tell you why doubles tennis has its own particular brand of excitement. The same is true for piano duos. They are a very rare breed, and James Magnusson and Leslie Kintin are just that. Their chemistry has kept them playing together for almost 40 years, and thanks to them, this fantastic world of music is going to be open for us today. Ladies and gentlemen, and Magnusson and Kintin.
Thank you.
Dvorak Slavonic dances are a great example of very popular orchestral music that began as a piano duo repertoire. This is actually for one piano, four hands, so you'll see the two musicians are sitting very closely together at the keyboard, and it's actually adorable to watch them. It's an example of one reason why this repertoire is so rich and why there's so much of it. Back in the 19th century, to sit down and play piano together was one of the very popular home entertainments. In Europe, every different country and ethnicity became very interested in establishing its musical and artistic identity. So many composers would turn to their folk music for inspiration as the basis for writing.
We decided to do a two-piano recital for the fun of it. We decided to do two or three. So I flew up to Toronto, and we went into the concert hall of the Royal Conservatory, and we said, let's do the Brahms Sonata. We decided to learn that. We sat down, and we played it, and the principal of the Royal Conservatory came in while we were playing, and we got to the end of the movement, and Leslie looked over, and he said to us, "My, you boys do this very well." And he said, "How long have you been at it?" And Leslie looked at his watch and said, 11 minutes.
Leslie, did you have any reservations about taking focus off of your own solo ambitions and starting this duo?
Actually not, because when we first started to play, neither of us, I think, had any intention of having a career as a duo. We were going to just continue building our career as soloists. And what was interesting for me is that I'd never played any legitimate two piano works until the very first rehearsal I had with Jim. I'd done concertos, and I'd read through some one piano forehand works, but never works for two pianos like we're playing today that were written for two pianos specifically. And as I say, we both were going to do it for fun, and then that was going to be it. And about 10 seconds after we started to play, I realized that I was totally wrong. What I really wanted to be was a duo pianist, except that I had no idea.
One of the great things about diving into this repertoire that we don't get to hear too often is that we can discover some wonderful composers who are overshadowed for some reason, as in the case of Anton Arensky, who we're going to hear from next. He's very well known as the teacher of Rachmaninoff, Scriabin, and Prokofiev, but he was actually a very, very fine composer, as we're about to hear.
The world of the repertoire is so rich. Jim, can you speak?
Yeah, I think neither of us realized there would be enough repertoire to sustain a career. And the truth is, as solo pianists, you have more repertoire than you can ever play. What we did not realize is that in the duo piano rep, every composer has written really a great piece, either for two pianos, often for two pianos, certainly for four hands. And that's kept us interested, fascinated, and given us an enormous amount of music to play and to continue to learn.
The fact that Agassiz and Kenton have an amazing chemistry should not fool you into thinking that they are exactly the same kind of pianist, because they aren't. Jim and Agassiz is well known for his lush, romantic approach, and Leslie Kenton for his more transparent, more pointillistic classical approach. And somehow, when they combine together, these two palettes fuse beautifully. Thank you. Leslie Kenton jokes that they gave each other nicknames according to their particular approaches to playing piano, which he said are Ben Marcato and Ben Legato, and it's not to do with anybody named Ben. Actually, in music, in Italian, Ben means very, and so Ben Legato means very smooth, and that would be Jim and Agnesen. And Ben Marcato means very articulated, and that would be Leslie Kenton.
I was trained very much in the classical tradition, and that's my temperament a little bit. My teacher was a student of Cortot's and Serkin's, so I came from through Mozart and Scarlatti and Bach and so forth.
And so what kind of
and then Jim was trained by one of the great romantic pianists, whoever, which was Eugene Liszt, and we both met in Beethoven. So because we both played Beethoven very much the same way, and we agree 100%, and we learned from each other that way. But because of the non-legato approach in a lot of classical repertoire and the other approach in romantic, we gave each other the nicknames of Ben Marcato and Ben Legato. So we were, which is, by the way, an Italian term for very legato and very Marcato. So, but that's what we came with. But then we developed our playing based on what the other person was doing.
Johannes Brahms wrote a lot of four hands and two pianos music, and one of his most popular works, which I said at the beginning of the show, is his Variations on a Theme by Haydn. Very, very simple tune that he creates a vast array of imaginative new ideas around. And it's heard mostly as an orchestral work, but originally it was for two pianos. And interestingly, as Leslie Kenton points out, when he orchestrated the piece, he actually had to make some changes because there were things that the orchestra couldn't do that the two pianos could do, which is kind of incredible to think about.
Thank you.
one thing that ultimately we both realized early is the learning process is difficult, but once we take the show on the road and play a piece, we actually never disagree.
Agnesen and Kinton are about to play Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue, which is a very famous piece, very popular and mostly heard. With piano and jazz orchestra, the sound of that glissando in the clarinet is really the signature moment in that piece. But the original manuscript is for two pianos, and he originally called it American Rhapsody. We'll be right back with more from the concert series. Nagnason and Kenton, an incredible duo who've been a rich part of our musical community and the world scene, bringing these gems to life for nearly 40 years. I hope you enjoyed their performance today. I'm Kathleen Kajioka. See you next time on the Concert Series.